Hare Krishna. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Let's recite the verses. Purusha prakriti stohi bhunte prakriti jan gunan karanam guna sangosya sada sadyoni janmasu upadrishtanu mantacha barta bhokta maheshvaraha paramatmeti chapi yukto dehesmin purusha paraha sarvayoni shukamteya murtaya sambhavantiya tasam brahma mahadyonir aham bija pradapita satvam shuke sanjayati rajam karmani bharata vyanam avritya tu tamaha pramadhe sanjayati utvaha urdvam gacchanti satvasta madhye tistanti rajasaha jaganya guna vrittista ado gacchanti tamasaha mamchayo vyabicharena bhakti yogena sevate sagunan samati taitan brahma bhuyaya kalpate brahmano hi pratistaham amritasya vyayasya cha shashvatasya cha dharmasya sukasya ikantikasya cha Sri Bhagavan Uvacha Urdva Moolam Adasakam Aswattam Prahuravyayam Chandam Siyasya Parnani Yasam Veda Saveda Ved Natad Bhashayate Suryo Nashashanko Napavakaha Yadgatva Nanivartante Taddama Paramam Mama Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatanaha Manasastani Indriyani Prakritistani Karshati Sarvasya Chaham Hridi Sannivishto Mata Smritir Jnanam Apohanam Cha Vedaischa Sarvai Rahameva Vedyo Vedanta Kridveda Vidyeva Chaham Trividam Narakasyedam Dwaram Nashanam Atmanaha Kama krodas tata lobas tasmad yetatrayam tyajet. Ya shastra viddhi mutsrijya vartate kama karataha nasa siddhim havapnoti nashukam na param gatim. Om tat sadidi nirdesho brahmanastri vidasmritaha brahmanastena vedascha yagyascha vihita pura yagya dana tapa karma natyajam karyam evatad yagyo danam tapaschaiva pavanani manishinam. Translation. Acts of sacrifice, charity and penance are not to be given up. They must be performed. Indeed, sacrifice, charity and penance purify even the great souls. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Let's start from where we left off. There were some devotees who were asking for a quick recap of what we have discussed so far. So I thought We'll quickly touch on what we discussed in the first class. We have so far covered two sessions in Nectar of Devotion. So in the first class, if you remember, we were discussing about the definition of pure devotional service, how there are three qualifications, primary qualifications for pure devotional service: Anukulyena, Krishna, Anushilanam. Anukulyena means it must be favorable, Krishna, it should be for Krishna, and Anushilanam. Anushilanam means there has to be some active cultivation. It's not passive meditation, Prabhupada was saying. It is an active cultivation. We need to put some effort in it. And the secondary characteristics of devotional service, we also saw in the same verse about how it should be free from two of the inebrieties, which is anyabhilashita shunyam. One should not have any other material desire. Jnana karmadi anavritam. One should be free from speculative knowledge. I was reading this life history of Madhvacharya. We all come in Brahma, Madhva, Gaudiya Sampradaya. That's the name of our lineage. Originally starts from Lord Brahma. Madhva, Gaudiya, Sampradaya. So this is our disciplic succession. So Prabhupada is one of the spiritual masters in this, and we all follow Prabhupada. So this is our, there are four sampradayas altogether, bona fide, that's given in the scriptures. One is Brahma. Brahma Sampradaya, Rudra Sampradaya, Kumara Sampradaya, Sri Sampradaya. So we have four different sampradaya, but our name of our sampradaya is Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya. Here Madhva refers to Madhvacharya. Incarnation of Vayu, or wind god. Now he goes for a debate, philosophical debate in one place, and there the person presents a Vedic aphorism, a Vedic statement, and he starts to twist the meaning. But Madhvacharya, then he quotes the scriptures and he says, every word in Vedas has three meanings. Every word in Mahabharata has 10 meanings. Every word in Vishnu Sahasranam, which is 1000 names of Lord Vishnu, comes as a section of Mahabharata. Sahasra Nama. Sahasra is 1000. Every word in Vishnu Sahasranama has 1000 meanings. Imagine if somebody is actually taking a Vedic statement, one, some reference in Mahabharata, they take the second meaning of one word there, and you know 30th meaning here. They can completely twist the meaning. So many permutations are there, so many combinations are there. So Madhvacharya says, every word in the Vedas, they have three meanings. Every word in Mahabharata has 10, and every word in Vishnu Sahasranam has 1000 meanings. So in that debate, then the opponent then challenges him. He was a Mayavad scholar, and then he challenges him. All right, if you say there are 1000 meanings, then proceed to explain. Then he starts with Vishnu Sahasranam, takes the very first word, there is 1000 names in it. He takes each one of the word, and for each word, he gives 1000 meanings. Then he goes to the second one. Then the opponent starts to doze off and he says, okay, I accept defeat. So, jnana karmadi anavritam, we should be free from speculation. We should always follow in the footsteps of the previous acharyas. So it's extremely important. This is one instruction Prabhupada also gives repeatedly. Mahajana yena katasa panta, which means we simply have to follow in the footsteps of the previous acharyas. So pure devotional service means we follow in the footsteps of the previous acharyas, and we also stick to simply fulfilling the desire of the Supreme Lord. So that is pure devotional service. So three primary characteristics is Anukulyena, Krishna, Anushilanam. It should be favorable for Krishna. It should be for Krishna, not for any demigod, not for our own personal aggrandizement, not for any of that. And Anushilanam, there has to be an active cultivation of devotional service, one of the 9 different processes, one or more, or a combination of all of them. And two things which it should be free of is anyabhilashita shunyam. One should not have any material desire, and one should be free from any speculation. Because we have this tendency to pick and choose always. Some instructions, they look very interesting for us, very favorable. Some instructions we find it very hard for us to accept. So what we tend to do is that we don't neither fully reject nor we fully accept, so we pick and choose. And sometimes there'll be differences also, even between devotees, husband and wife, between two friends, two Prabhus, two Matajis, we always twist. And we said, this is important, that is important, Prabhupada said this, Prabhupada said that. So we try to actually twist the context also. But what we need to understand is, the scriptures are there, but there are sadhus who follow the scriptures, so we need to take into consideration everything, and then we have to follow it properly. So that is pure devotional service, we saw. So after that, we saw in the first class, there are six effects of devotional service. Klesha Agni, Shubhada, Moksha Laguta Krit, Sudurlabha, Sandarananda Visheshatma, Sri Krishna Karshani. So we saw six characteristics of pure devotional service. And we also saw how Nectar of Devotion, it has different oceans, different sections of the ocean, north, south, east and west. What we are going to focus as part of our study, at this point of time, will be the first 19 chapters or the eastern side of the ocean. So this one has got 19 chapters, 1, 17 to 18, then we have 2 to 16, and then 19. 1 discusses on Samanya Bhakti, or the overview of devotional service. 2 to 16, Sadhana Bhakti, or the devotional service in practice, how to chant, how to come to temple, how to worship the deities, everything. 17 to 18, we saw Bhava Bhakti. So they're all Bhakti. And then this is Prema Bhakti. Bhava Bhakti means devotional service in ecstasy. Prema Bhakti means devotional service in pure love of Godhead. Pure love of Godhead. When Krishna Prema, we actually offer these ones. So this is how we saw in the first chapter. Second chapter, last week, we were very fortunate to have His Holiness Devamrit Swami Maharaj. He was explaining to us about different types of sadhana bhakti. So if you see the second chapter, there are two types of sadhana bhakti. One is Vaidhi Bhakti and the other is Raga Anuga. So this is how we discussed in the second chapter. So if you take sadhana bhakti, they are of two types. One is called Vaidhi or bhakti based on regulative principles, based on rules and regulations. And Raga Anuga or spontaneous devotional service. The primary difference between both of them is where we derive the inspiration from. That's the deciding factor in both of them. In Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti, what we do is we derive inspiration from primarily instructions of the Guru. Maharaj was quoting Srila Prabhupada saying, Vaidhi Bhakti means you do because I ask you to do. There I refers to the spiritual master, the Guru, scriptures. So Vaidhi Bhakti means one who follows the process of devotional service. Wake up early in the morning, chant 16 rounds. We are all doing, we may not have that much inspiration to do it spontaneously. Nevertheless, we still follow on the order of the spiritual master. Even could be preaching, could be book distribution, cooking, anything. None of us are eligible to actually perform devotional service. Even to worship Sri Sri Radha Gopinath, we are not qualified. So we go through the paramparas, go through our spiritual master like that. Okay, so that is Vaidhi Bhakti. As I said, the deciding factor in both of them, or the prime differentiating factor between both of them is, where do we get the inspiration from, or the source of inspiration? In one, we take the source of inspiration from Guru and scriptures, whereas in the other, Raganuga platform, we take inspiration spontaneously. And Maharaj was giving example, spontaneously means we don't need any other extra trigger, external trigger rather, we have bhakti in our heart. So Maharaj was focusing on that point for quite some time last week, if you remember. Prabhupada gives this example. As soon as a baby is born, the ability to walk is there, dormant in the baby. The baby just needs to be trained in order to be able to walk. So same way, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a verse, Nitya Siddha Krishna Prema Sadhya Kabunoy. Shravanadi Shuddha Chite Karaya Udai, which means as soon as we are born in this world, what is inherent in our soul, inherent in our heart is bhakti, is loving devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. However, it is in dormant state. How do we awaken that? Shravanadi, simply by hearing and association. Adi means all of the similar activities. By hearing, associating, today we are going to discuss about that more. Simply by coming in contact with devotees, with the deities, with so many different practices, we then qualify ourselves to practice devotional service. So that is inherent in us. All of these are just meant to bring out that inherent bhakti, inherent love and devotion from our heart. Okay, so that's how Prabhupada actually explains in previous chapter. So Prabhupada gives this beautiful analogy. You can always remember, sometimes we think even in our bhakti, bhakti looks so external. Bhakti looks so artificial. Have you come across that face? I go through that every day. So it's hard. Like, you know, morning you are very enthusiastic. You do devotional service. And then sometimes you are in your room, you don't know, what am I doing here? Who am I? You know, we get all those questions and we don't know, we freeze also. We don't know how to do. That's why we need to have proper planning, proper guidance and everything in order to maintain the priority. There are services, things, activities we should do on our devotional service as a matter of inspiration. Some we may do as a matter of duty also, but that balance has to be there. Okay, some of us may like to sing kirtan just for ourselves. Now we should still pursue that interest to keep our bhakti a bit abreast of like all other push and pull. So it's very important that we understand that balance to be able to practice it. But Prabhupada actually says this bhakti is already dormant in our heart. But for us, in order to be in that elevated transcendental platform all the time, it takes practice. That consistency, it takes time, it takes patience. That's why we studied, if you remember, in Nectar of Instruction, Utsahan, Nishchaya, Dharya, there has to be enthusiasm, there has to be patience, there has to be determination. So all those qualities come to our aid at those points. In any case, because we are not in that level of a spontaneous devotional service, there is a certain amount of rules that's required to push us. So that's why Vaidhis are there. They are the safety net. Now we should not mistake, if we go to Raganuga or spontaneous devotional service, there is no rule and regulation. That's not how it works. Rules and regulations are there as the primary drive for us to practice bhakti in this stage. Whereas if we go to spontaneous devotional service stage, we don't need that extra push from outside. It becomes part of our system, which means, I remember when I started practicing Krishna consciousness, I was staying with a devotee and he told me, I asked him about the difference between these two. What is Vaidhi and what is Raganuga? He said that if you wake up before your alarm goes off, that's Raganuga. But if you switch off the alarm and continue sleeping, that's Vaidhi. So early in the morning, if the alarm goes, you need an external trigger to wake up. Whereas you see, you study the activities of the gopis. Gopis, they didn't need anything external to actually come and stop. In fact, they struggled very hard to forget Krishna. They go to tapasya to simply forget Krishna. For us, it's the other way around. It's interesting, remembering waking up in the morning. One of Sri Vaishnava's alvars, his name is Kulashekara. Kulashekara Alvar. He's a king. Very powerful king, but very, very elevated devotee. He's one of the 12 Alvars, one of the 12 Acharyas of Sri Sampradaya. Usually he wakes up in the morning and he instructs the servants, even before he wakes up, he wants to wake up hearing about the holy name, hearing the holy name of Krishna. So he'll have all these men around his bed and they will sing. And he'll wake up for Mangalarati and then he'll go to temple in that mood always. That's a Vaishnava king. So one day they tried knocking on his door, the door doesn't open. He just sleeps, skips Mangalarati. Finally, all the guards in the palace, they think something untoward happened inside. So they break the door open and they come in and they still see him sleeping on the bed. And they come slowly and they touch and then suddenly he wakes up as if somebody disturbed him from meditation. And then he comes out and he says, Krishna came in my dream. And then immediately he starts to write. What he writes as part of his meditation, as Krishna revealed to him, came to be known as Mukunda Mala Stotra. Prabhupada translated part of this. And Prabhupada's disciples finished it. There's a small book, you'll actually see beautiful prayers he offers to Lord Krishna. Now, this is still Raganuga Bhakti only. If tomorrow somebody wakes you up for Mangalarati, don't say Krishna is meditating. Which is fine. Now write another Mukunda Malastotra, spontaneous prayer. Then you know the proof, whether the person was actually dozing or whether he was actually meditating on Krishna. So I'm saying in Raganuga platform, spontaneous devotional services, sometimes it may seem that they are breaking the rules, but actually it's not. They still follow the rules, but spontaneously. As I said, they still wake up for Mangalarati, but without any external help. So that is spontaneous devotional service. Now, in some aspects of Krishna consciousness, we have spontaneous attraction. Okay, like maybe coming to temple, taking prasad. You don't need anyone to externally tell us. Okay, even for many of us, we love kirtans. We just put kirtan. Even as before coming to Krishna consciousness, some of us may even have got attraction for music, for example. Devotional music even. So there are some aspects of Krishna consciousness which we all have attraction to, which may come spontaneously. But actual Raganuga platform means every aspect of devotional service will be spontaneous. You wouldn't be looking at Ekadashi. Usually we think Ekadashi is our enemy. But Ekadashi is Bhakti Janani. She gives birth to Bhakti, actually. But we tend to think Ekadashi, 2 days. And then one day, we have this huge meal one evening before Ekadashi, correct? Because we are going to fast. Because I'm going to fast from grain. And then on Ekadashi, we still think, today I'm not eating grain, so I need more energy. We still end up eating more. But actually, that's not spontaneous devotional service. Spontaneous is, we take the principles, it's part of our value system, so much so that the bhakti, which is dormant in our heart when we are born, becomes completely manifest, completely awakened. That we don't no longer need somebody to actually tell us, go to the temple. We feel at home in the temple. We feel something is missing if we don't chant Hare Krishna like that. So that is Raganuga. Whereas Vaidhi, we still push. Now, what process should we follow? We should always follow Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti, hoping that one day we'll become Raganuga Bhaktas. But till we die, this is the process we are going to follow. We don't need to artificially jump ourselves to a position where for which we are not at all qualified. We shouldn't. So we have to be careful there that we understand how the process works. We understand and it helps us also to appreciate. Bhakti is something which is, there's always things for us to conquer. There are always challenges that are going to be there to give us that sense of achievement, positively if you want to think. So we should always be aiming to go to that perfect level. But just like Krishna, bhakti is also unlimited. So we'll never come to the end of it. It's impossible. Srimati Radharani herself, after serving Krishna, she feels, I'm not doing enough. I mean, where are we? So we'll never come to the point wherein we can say, I'm following all the rules perfectly. We don't do that at all. So it's important for us to understand. So this is what we discussed last week in second chapter. The first stage of devotion, or how to practice devotional service in the beginning stage. Now, if you look at the contents of your book, so say part one, as I said, 19 chapters. So the first chapter we discussed, this is Samanya Bhakti, characteristics of pure devotional service. And we said how from 2 to 16, we are going to discuss about Sadhana Bhakti. But in 2 to 16, there is still a subcategory. So from chapter 3 to 14, we are going to talk about only rules and regulations, which is Vaidhi. 15 and 16, we are going to discuss about Raganuga Bhakti. So if you look at your book, you will see from chapter 3, starting from today until chapter 14, we are going to discuss about Vaidhi, or going to be based on rules and regulations. You'll be amazed in how much detail all these rules are given here. And for every aspect of our Krishna consciousness, you will find a direct correlation in this. In fact, Prabhupada established all the program, every aspect of Krishna consciousness in our practice, based on these principles of Srila Rupa Goswami in Nectar of Devotion. So every single thing, why do we come for Tulsi Arati? Why should we bow down to Tulsi Marani? Why should we take Charanamrita? Why should we come in front of the deity? Why should we say Hare Krishna? Every single thing. You will find in detail from chapter 3 to 14. 15 and 16, it speaks about spontaneous devotional service. So that's chapter 15. And 16 is further explained, which is a bit more detailed there. Then 17 and 18, we are going to discuss about Bhava Bhakti, and 19 is Prema Bhakti. Okay, so that's the overview of what we have ahead of us. With that background, let's start with today. Today's chapter is very small. Some of these aspects that's actually given in this chapter, we have discussed in chapter 7 of Bhagavad Gita. We'll go through them again. Eligibility or the qualification for one practicing devotional service. In other words, what qualifies one to practice devotional service in his life? Eligibility of the candidate for accepting devotional service. Now, you might have heard about this statement, bhakti sanjayate bhakti, which means bhakti comes from bhakti. The origin of bhakti is bhakti itself. We discussed how when a baby was actually born, the baby has the dormant capacity to walk, built-in capacity to walk, but it may not be manifest. Slowly, initially crawls, and then toddles, and then finally, the baby comes to a stable position to be able to walk. So same way, in our heart also, bhakti is there, dormant. Today we are going to discuss what are the different stages that helps us to bring out that bhakti to be manifested totally in our activities, in our lifestyle. So that's what this chapter is about. As I said, chapter 2 discussed about the devotional service and practice. Chapter 3 is going to talk about qualifications to practice devotional service. So that's chapter 3. Now, Prabhupada, he opens the chapter saying there's one primary qualification for somebody to practice bhakti. Attraction to Krishna. Now, all of us inherently, even before we come to Krishna consciousness, if we remember, when was the first time I saw Krishna? Sometimes first time when I was a child, I saw Krishna's picture. It was a very unusual pose, the way how Krishna stands in Tribhanga form. We see different gods doing different activities. Usually we tend to think something which is associated with power will be like a weapon. You take Shiva, he'll have a Trishul, or you take Durga, anyone for that matter, or you take a Hanumanji, he has, or different, or Lord Ram, for example, even, he has a bow. Vishnu, Chanka, Chakra, Kada, Padma, different instruments, different weapon they all have. But when you see Krishna very coolly just plays flute, very unusual position, very soothing posture Krishna has, and it evokes a certain curiosity in us. What is he doing? First thing that confuses us is, if somebody holds a weapon, you know he's going to give protection, but Krishna is playing flute, what is he going to give me? That question comes naturally. That curiosity, inquisitiveness naturally happens. Either he's stealing butter, he himself is running away, or everything unusual, or he's herding cows. How is that relevant to me? How is that gonna make me feel any good? We all have that inquisitiveness. There's something very unique, very peculiar about Krishna that attracts us, if we know about who Krishna is. Or if somebody who doesn't know anything about Krishna, let's say you come in contact with food, they may eat, and then we think, what is this? I've never taken anything. I've eaten so many different types of foods, but there is something in this food which you can't really put in words what the X factor is. So same way could be music, for example. You can hear so many different spiritual music, but when you hear about holy name of Krishna, there will be something inexplicable that happens inside our heart. If we remember, what is it that brought us to Krishna consciousness? We'll see. Or first time you come into temple, I still remember very first day I come and the altar was closed. I came at 1 o'clock, 1:30 in the afternoon. I came from Adelaide. I couldn't get darshan. As I was going out, there was one brahmachari who sold me his Krishna book. I was asking, then he brought it. There was no Krishna book at that time. Then I took it, I was reading on flight all the way back. So all of us have that experience. When was the first time I came? What is it that attracted us? So on and so forth. Now, when this happens, initially, innocently, we have that openness and we accept it very easily. Ramanujacharya once walks on the banks of River Kaveri. If you go to Srirangam, you'll see such a beautiful river. The bed of the river is like sand completely. They have quicksand also, but it's very, very beautiful place. Even now if you go, it's an island. So Ramanujacharya, once he walks, and then his disciple brings Mahaprasad from Lord Ranganath. He takes few grains of that and he throws in the water. And then he sees a few fishes come, they eat, and then bloop, they just drop their body, assume 400 Vishnu form, and they go right in front of everyone's eyes. They go back to spiritual world. Many of them. Then Ramanujacharya takes another handful of grain, again throws in the for the fishes. Again, a few other group of fishes come, they eat, and they go back to spiritual world. If you are one of the disciples of Ramanujacharya, what question would you have? Naturally, we will think, I'm also eating Mahaprasad. Why am I not going to spiritual world? And the disciples do ask that question to Ramanujacharya. And he says, when I gave that grain to the fishes, they have the innocent faith that they just come, they'll happily come and they'll take. That's how they bite on the bait also sometimes when they do fishing. So totally they surrender to that and they just come and eat, and that was all that was required. Complete taking, complete shelter of the mercy that's given to us. And once they did that, that was enough for them to actually get liberated. That goes to show how skeptical we are even in the potency of Mahaprasad, even in the potency of this process. Even though initially that understanding that contrast was very easy for us. We come from a totally rotten, distressed background. We took shelter of bhakti. At that time, we could clearly perceive what bhakti has got to offer to me versus what I was bereft of before. It was very easy. We can easily compare and we come and take a complete shelter. But then as we progress over a period of time, we'll actually see we are not even getting that initial level of ecstasy. How many of you have that experience? And I think we feel sometimes also looks like I was in a more advanced stage then and I actually went down now. Actually, the process, the way how it works is initially when we actually come, totally we were able to take shelter. We were able to appreciate. We felt, wow, if I come open the darshan, if I can see Krishna, we felt ourselves lucky. Then if we come take some prasad, we felt ourselves lucky. If we made it to the class, we felt ourselves lucky like that. But familiarity breeds contempt. As time actually goes on, we don't maintain the same level of appreciation. We don't maintain the same level of gratitude in our heart. And that makes it difficult for us to perceive. If Krishna comes and he says something, I'll give you love of Godhead. We are not in a position currently to be just satisfied with bhakti. So we need to be honest with ourselves. And as we actually read this book, this is not to make us feel negative, but this is for us to understand how much more we need to actually progress. Utsahan nishchayat dhairyat. We need to keep reminding ourselves. There is patience required. There is determination that's required. There is confidence that's required. But when we actually take this power of association, do progress on this path slowly, 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 we will see that same ecstasy would come multiplied a million folds. That same gratitude will actually come back to us with much, much more intensified vigor. But we need patience. Slowly. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's associates, when they eat prasad, if you read Chaitanya Charitamrita, you will see so many pastimes around prasadam distribution only. 10, 15 chapters on that. Just eating, what did they eat, what are the different items they ate, what order, who served, you'll find in so much elaborate description in Chaitanya Charitamrita. But if you see there, they just take a handful of food, they eat the prasad, between every bite they'll go to ecstasy. But we tend to think eating means, okay, it's like Sunday feast plate, we are just going to devour on that. It's not like that. For every bite they go, they'll chant Hare Krishna, and they'll go to ecstasy. Come back after half an hour and they continue eating again. So it's like that. What they relished was way different to what we tend to usually. So it's important for us to understand, okay, so there is so much to actually achieve. That is not to make us feel negative. That should make us feel dependent on Vaishnavas. That should make us feel dependent on Krishna. That should make us feel humble all the time. We should never feel proud. Completely understanding how much more to conquer on our path of progress. So we need to understand. So bhakti, sanjayate bhakti. Initially bhakti starts with attraction to Krishna. But that attraction doesn't come naturally. Somebody must have guided us, go to the temple. Or go to Govinda's, attend Kirtan, or go to a restaurant to take prasad. Different aspects, different ways how we get connected. But somehow we developed that little attraction. Now that initial attraction is okay. They are Vartama Pratakshaka Guru, which means whoever who showed us the path, they are Vartama Pratakshaka Guru, which means one who showed us the path. So if a person now comes in contact with Krishna consciousness somehow or other, what is it that's going to push him or her to take up this process completely? Nectar of Devotion in Rupa Goswami, he explains, this attraction becomes manifest. It's dormant in our heart, which means it's sleeping, hibernation. It awakens by sadhu sangha. By association of pure devotees. And in Srimad Bhagavatam, if you see, there are many stories that actually describe about this. One story comes to mind is Narada Muni. Prabhupada says Narada boy. In his previous life, his mother, she was a heavenly damsel in her previous life. She gets cursed and she's born. Her name was Kalavati. That's Narada Muni's. We always see Narada Muni was born to a maidservant. So that's her name is Kalavati. Single parent, single mother. And she has this 5-year-old child. They live in the forest during rainy season, Chaturmasya, 4 months in a year. Few Bhaktivedantas or pure devotees of the Lord, they come and they stop by in her home. Usually during the rainy season, the Bhaktivedantas or the pure devotees, they don't travel anywhere. They just stay in one place, follow the rules and regulations strictly. They study scriptures and they preach in that locality. You see, even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as a sannyasi, he followed that lifestyle. So when they come to this place, she takes that opportunity to serve them. She cooks the food, and Narada Muni, who was a boy, who was her child, he would go serve, 5-year-old boy, go serve every single day. But as he was serving, he was also hearing what they were discussing. Different things about the Supreme Lord, Holy Name, everything. And he used to hear, simply by hearing, that was enough for him to get attracted towards bhakti. And after they finish eating, every single time, he will take their permission. Can I take remnants? Now they are sadhus being so merciful with about on this little child, they say they gave permission. Prabhupada, he writes in the purport that, so that's how everyone should be, that should be the attitude of everyone practicing bhakti. Either with permission or even without permission, one should be always seeking to take Mahaprasad. Now that's in no way to authorize you stealing prasad, but I'm just saying we should be eager to take. So Narada Muni then taking their permission, he was taking prasad. And then simply by hearing, he developed that attraction towards the Supreme Lord. 4 months finished, the Bhaktivedantas, they move on in their path of pilgrimage. And one day his mother, she dies, bitten by a snake. Imagine single mother and little child, a tiny little child. And he's just a boy, he doesn't know what to do. Very heartrending position, actually he was in, if you think about it. So then at that position, but Narada Muni at that point of time, he does the final rites. The knowledge which he had actually heard from the Bhaktivedantas comes to aid. Immediately he takes this opportunity, rather than if we are in the position, what would we do? Narada Muni as a little boy at that point of time, he took complete shelter of the knowledge. He took that as an opportunity and he moved on. As a 5-year-old boy, he was like roaming on the surface of the earth, different places, goes to forest, sits in meditation, because he learned everything, the techniques of meditation, who he should worship, everything Bhaktivedantas have actually taught him, even though he was a 5-year-old boy. So when a crisis hits his life, he takes a complete shelter, turns his weakness into strength, turns the challenge into an opportunity. He goes there, meditates on the Supreme Lord, and as he actually meditating, one day Vishnu appears on his heart, just for very, very tiny period. And then Narada Muni sits and meditates, and then Vishnu says, how you see, you have been meditating on me. This is the form I have. And I bless you that you will actually attain success in this life. However, you are not going to see me again. He is still a tiny little boy. This is previous yugas. You can understand how many thousands of years he is said to live. But then he meditates, sees the Supreme Lord, and then that's it. Vanishes straight away. And then he gets choked up by this emotion. Tiny little child. He doesn't know what to do, and then he goes back again to meditation, hoping to see. You can understand how little child would actually react in that situation. Exactly, that's what he was going through. And then he cries for Supreme Lord. Rest of his life, diligently he practices bhakti. Now, are we in that position? Very similar. First time when we came in front of Radha Gopinath, curtain opens, we saw Krishna. Narada Muni saw Krishna only once. We are seeing Krishna every single time, throughout the day. Why is it we are not able to take that much shelter? Narada Muni actually says, because of Sarva Upadhi, which means we come with a lot of baggage because of our conditioning. So the whole process of bhakti is simply to do Cheto Darpana Marjan. As we chant Hare Krishna more and more and more and more and more, we scrub layers and layers and layers of that material designation. He calls it Sarva Upadhi. Sarva Upadhi. Or material, artificial material designations which we carry in our heart. But as we practice this process of bhakti, what happens is, it's like scrubbing these layers and layers of misidentification, that I'm not the body, but I'm the soul. As we keep doing it, over a period of time, we'll be able to go deep down and then realize that we are the soul, and then we'll be able to be in a position to take complete shelter of the Supreme Lord. How we are going to do, that's what Nectar of Devotion is going to teach us. So, the qualification to practice bhakti is simply attraction to the Supreme Lord. And that attraction, we don't have it spontaneously awakened. For that, we need association of devotees. Those who are in a position to practice devotional service may not be in Uttama Adhikari platform, but at least consistently, non-stop. All of us, we need to take association. We need to have at least one or two or even a few devotees who, for us to look up to, who is like a good role model for us, who we can actually take shelter of, and we can understand, okay, so this is how this devotee is practicing devotional service, this is how this devotee is staying attached to Krishna, let me also take ideas. That's why even in our scripture study, studying scriptures is one, there was one, actually few devotees were asking, do we need to invite guests? The idea of inviting guests from outside is to take inspiration from them. You come, we can relish bhakti simply by seeing how they relish bhakti. We can take that idea and we can put that into practice for us. We can learn just one single concept. Philosophically, it may not be more, but we'll definitely go deeper in how much ever we actually learn. So that's very important. And same way, when we come for any Bhagavatam class, any class, some devotees are good in speaking, some devotees may not be. Some devotees can keep the class interesting, some may not be. Nevertheless, because we should always approach the scriptures in a respectful mood, we should always still come, and rather than getting distracted by who the speaker is, how he or she speaks, how well he or she speaks, rather than getting distracted by it, our sole focus should be simply on what is it that Sri Radha Gopinath conveying to me today through this particular devotee. That's the proper mood with which we go, and if we go with that proper mood, every class will be interesting. You'll be amazed. Every single devotee will be inspiring for us. One devotee was asking Srila Prabhupada, Prahlad Maharaj was just a tiny little child. How did he cope up with all the atrocities that was done against him by his father? And Prabhupada is saying, he saw everything has been sent by Krishna. And Prabhupada is saying, today if they drop atom bomb, Prabhupada says, this is Krishna. This is how devotee will actually think. And Prabhupada was not just making a joke, he himself behaved like that. There was a time when there was war between India and neighboring country. They were dropping bombs even in Kolkata. And Prabhupada asked his wife to make kachoris. Prabhupada was eating kachoris and he was doing Krishna bhajan happily. Prabhupada never cared about that. Same way when there was war between India and Pakistan later, even after ISKCON was established, there was a blackout throughout. Prabhupada had the candle on and Prabhupada continued with preaching. Prabhupada never cared, and Prabhupada always used to say, Mare Krishna Rake Ke, Rake Krishna Mare Ke, which means if Krishna wants to kill somebody, nobody can protect him. If Krishna wants to protect somebody, nobody can kill him. Okay, so it's important for us to understand, to keep ourselves always inspired to take shelter of devotees, take shelter. Now, many times mentally we do aparad. Why is this speaker giving class, or why is this Prabhu, this Mataji, even Kirtan also, for example. So, same way, when we actually have any devotee actually leading Kirtan, our mood should simply be, okay, here is Krishna's holy name, which is Krishna, I'm simply going to join with this particular devotee, inspiring myself and inspiring this devotee also, because both singer as well as the one who follows, everyone takes inspiration. That should be the proper mood. If we do that, then that same freshness which we carried initially, which we innocently did, which we innocently experienced when we came to Krishna consciousness first time, now in a more mature platform, we'll be able to appreciate more. That's why I'm saying, scriptures say that we'll be able to experience that level of same freshness, that level of enthusiasm, that level of vigor, push to practice, push to take shelter, in exactly same as how when we started originally, it is possible in a much, much more intense level if we simply practice this process with a much, much more deeper level of connection, deeper level of appreciation. So that's why association of devotees is very important, because Krishna always reveals himself. Krishna always reveals deeper level of knowledge only in the association of devotees, irrespective of who the speaker is. Prabhupada says, speaker is just a messenger. What we should be more interested is, what message is Krishna giving us? There's one disciple of Prabhupada, and look at how personal he is. When he reads Prabhupada's purports, his name is, I forgot his name, but let us say, Satadanya Das, for example. If there is, he'll read the verse, the Sanskrit, he will read the translation of the verse. Before he reading the purport, he would add, my dear Satadanya, and then he'll continue reading the purport. As if Prabhupada wrote the purport in a letter to him, you understand? He takes it personally. Try reading it. Sometimes if I remember, I do it like that whenever I remember. If you do it, you will understand how personal Prabhupada is. Otherwise, we tend to think, Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna had problem, as if we are in a very elevated platform. Actually, Arjuna's problem is our problem. So Arjuna is representing us. We tend to even put all bhakti, everything. Prahlad Maharaj had problem. Hiranyakashipu was a demon. And sometimes you look inside, Hiranyakashipu will be inside us also. We also have that tendency. So what did he do wrong? Why did he do wrong? What should I do to not follow in the same path? Sometimes devotees ask me a question. And the question is, Prabhu, no matter how many classes I attend, I'm not getting any questions at all. Is it good or bad? Good question. So, if we attend in a class and we take bhakti and knowledge which we actually get as someone telling to someone, you won't get any question at all. Never. Because it's someone's conversation, correct? We don't take it personal. However, everything which we actually hear, we take it, we try to follow it, even at least mentally, when you actually foresee yourself following, you will naturally have challenges. You will naturally have questions. If you don't have any impediments at all, maybe we are in pure devotional platform, which we are not in, by the way. Which means we need to accept, try to take that knowledge as something which has been given to us, custom made by Sri Sri Radha Gopinath, custom made by Prabhupada. If we take that knowledge, take that realization inside, and we try to apply that, naturally we'll have questions. Naturally we'll have challenges. Naturally we seek clarity. We need guidance. That's the way how we should approach. If we go like that, then no class will be boring. We can go sit in the class approaching, okay, what is it Krishna is going to tell me today in the class? I think today he communicated very clearly. Like that you come for every class. Not just this, any class. Usually there is this tendency, I will see who is the speaker, I'll see who is going to give class. This devotee tells stories, this devotee just repeats only what's in the book, or this devotee speaks only philosophy. We don't need to. We need everything. We need to understand the pastimes, we need to understand philosophy, we need to understand the devotee's realizations. We also need to understand some devotees, they just speak spontaneously. They may not even touch on the scriptures at all. Even that is needed. What we should be seeking is, what is it that this devotee is good at? What is this that this devotee is expert in? Otherwise, if we go there trying to see the perfect role model, we'll only get disappointed everywhere. But if we go, Bhaktivedanta Purna Maharaj once, he said, if you go to learn violin from someone, just look up to him only to learn violin. Don't try to make a role model out of him. We will get disappointed. One person who is best in everything is Sri Sri Radha Gopinath. That's the only person. But we try to seek Krishna everywhere and we get disappointed again and again, and we demonize people, we show prejudice against people, and we say like, oh no, this person is good, this person is bad and everything, completely missing the point. So coming back to this point, eligibility is simply attraction towards Krishna. And how do we get that? How do we evoke that in our heart? Simply by associating with these devotees. Yes, simply if we do that, then over a period of time, we will actually see that sadhu sangha will evoke attraction towards bhakti, and that bhakti will slowly sprout in our heart. Now, Prabhupada then touches on two factors that determine what level devotees are in. We discussed this in Nectar of Instruction also. There are three types of devotees. One is first class, second class, third class. Prabhupada says, Kanishta, Madhyama, and Uttama. Uttama is first class, Madhyama second, this is third. We discussed this in Nectar of Instruction also. We'll discuss it here. Same author writes in Nectar of Devotion also. We'll discuss that when we study Srimad Bhagavatam as well. It's there in Srimad Bhagavatam, it's there in Chaitanya Charitamrita also. So the same knowledge, it's actually given repeatedly for more clarity with more detail. Now, what are the factors that determine a person which category he fall under? Different factors, but for this chapter, Prabhupada and Rupa Goswami for that matter, he touches on only two. One is faith, that is one aspect, and the second is wisdom. Knowledge of Shastras. So based on faith and based on wisdom, a devotee can be categorized as falling in one of these three categories. Kanishta, Prabhupada would call that neophyte. Madhyama, or somebody in intermediate level. Or Uttama, somebody in the topmost level or first class devotee. So somebody who is an Uttama Adhikari, he would have his faith very, very strong, and his knowledge will also be very, very strong. Wisdom will also be very, very strong. He'll be, Prabhupada says, such a person, an Uttama Adhikari, he has very unshakable faith. He or she also has knowledge. Knowledge doesn't mean how many verses you know. That's not what knowledge is. Knowledge is the conviction which we have in the process. The knowledge is the realization which we have by following this process. Why we do what we do. That conviction, that's wisdom. That's why we don't usually say knowledge of the scriptures. It's true, the person also has knowledge of the scriptures. What we mean here is the realized knowledge, not just the theoretical knowledge. Okay, so that is wisdom. So a person who is an Uttama Adhikari, topmost platform, he or she has very, very strong faith, is very, very good, expert in the realizations, expert in the knowledge of the scriptures, and such person will be able to convince other people also with that. One in Madhyama Adhikari, again, faith is very, very strong. However, the knowledge or the wisdom or the realization is not as strong as Uttama Adhikari. And such person in Madhyama Adhikari level won't be able to convince other people with that. But nobody, he would not allow anybody to come and shake his faith either. He is very clear. And we can actually see, we fall in a bit of each of those categories. I mean, not so much here, where most of us are just here. Maybe all of us are here, we don't know. Some may be here. But we are strong in our faith. Even if somebody comes and asks this question, we may be able to answer, but only to a certain point. After that, why should we do this? I don't know, but I'm not going to change. We are very strong in our practice. Correct? So that is Madhyama Adhikari. Okay? Faith is strong, but knowledge not necessarily strong. At least not to the extent to be able to convince other people to follow the path, but strong enough for us to hold on to our faith. Okay? So that is Madhyama. Kanishta, or the neophyte stage, faith is weak. Which means anybody can just walk in, they can disturb their faith, and they'll just walk away. Not to be seen again. Knowledge is also very, very weak. Prabhupada says that's why studying scriptures is so important. Now, We should not go to the other extreme and saying, anyway, what's the use of theoretical knowledge? That's not the idea. We should take as much help as possible to take that theoretical knowledge so that we can go deep and put that into practice. And by virtue of that, we'll get realization. There has to be some way how we get realization. That's how we get. We study the scriptures, take the theoretical knowledge, take that, imbibe it, try to put that into practice. That theoretical knowledge, jnana, will in turn become vijnana. That theoretical knowledge will become our realizations, will become the cherished values of our life. So that's important. Okay. So scripture study class is still important. I need to keep covering our back. So it is still important. So that's how each of these three different categories are explained. Now Prabhupada extends further from here, explaining how even in Kanishta Adhikari platform, there are four types. As you can see, there's a good flow. We saw in Bhagavad Gita also, Chaturvidha Bhajante Mam, Jana Shukritun Arjuna, Artho Jignyashu Artharthi. So four types of people come to Krishna. One who is distressed, one who is in need of something, one who is inquisitive, and fourth one, Prabhupada calls it wise in this chapter. In Bhagavad Gita, we saw one who is in search of absolute truth. So there are four types of neophytes. So these four types of people, they come to Krishna. Krishna calls all of them magnanimous. Why? Because somebody who is distressed, do you know somebody who is stressed out, but who doesn't come to Krishna? Almost the whole population, correct? How many people say, I'm stressed out, so I'm coming to Hare Krishna temple? Very, very few. Correct? That's why Krishna is saying, people who are distressed and come to me, they are magnanimous. They could have gone anywhere, but they have come to me. In fact, same way, needy. How many people come to Krishna, knocking on Krishna's door, because he or she needs something? Very, very tiny. Everyone goes elsewhere. Same inquisitiveness. Everywhere except to Krishna. People who are wise. People who are in search of absolute truth. Anywhere except Krishna. So Krishna says, not every person who is stressed out comes to me. Very, very tiny, tiny bit. People only come to me. So Krishna is saying, because very, very few people come to me, even though accidentally, somehow or other, they have come to me, Krishna calls all of them as pious. Jana Shukritina Arjuna. They are full of piety. So Krishna categorizes all of them as pious. Somebody asked Devamrita Maharaj this question in a class. You know, sometimes you go on Harinam, you'll find people coming there and making fun even. Or sometime you give prasad to people in the street. Could be cookie, could be anything. They just throw. Or somebody takes it, really swears at you and goes aside and eats. Or somebody just swears at you, doesn't show any favorable disposition towards Hare Krishna's, he still goes on with his business. So does the person benefit? That's the question. Maharaj said, yes, if a person comes in the street, hears the holy name, still acts in an unfavorable way. Of course, he did some mistake there. So as soon as he goes, the karma will actually take effect on him for temporarily. However, even he says, even before the bad karma starts to manifest, the holy name will actually act on him and he'll become a devotee. That's the power, actually. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he actually explains that Vedas don't have the power to describe about the glories. Vedas are also personalities. If you read Krishna book, you will see Vedas are personalities. It's interesting. If you read Krishna book, every single time when Krishna comes down, Krishna comes once in a day of Brahma. If you read 11th canto, you'll actually see the description. Actually, 10th one, 10th canto. Vedas are personalities. Every time Krishna comes down, because Vedas speak about, we were discussing, karma kanda, jnana kanda, upasana kanda, mainly about fruitive mentality or about jnana or upasana. Touches on worship, but not so much about pure devotional service. Demigod worship, maybe. Not really demigod worship. Introduces about Krishna, everything, but not really pure devotional service. Doesn't speak much about that. So Vedas, they are a personification of that, but Vedas are not in their pure form yet. So every time Krishna comes, if you read Krishna book, you will see prayed by personified Vedas. There is such a section there. Bhagavatam explains, every time Krishna comes, the personification of Vedas, in the form of a small child, they go in front of Krishna, glorify, in the form of, they can take any form also. They come, glorify Krishna. Simply by glorifying Krishna, they become pure. And when Krishna goes back to spiritual world, they also assume a new form and they go. Which means, every single time Krishna comes, Krishna liberates even the Vedas. And Brahma has to create Vedas again, personalities. Understand? Just like, you know, you have temple president, vice president, likewise you have Rig Veda, Yajur, Sama, Atharva. They are personalities. Every time Krishna comes, they come offer pure prayers. If you read, that's the significance of that chapter. Otherwise, if you look at it, this chapter, Prabhu, there is no story in this, Prabhu. Our whole mood was always entertainment. We want entertainment even in Krishna consciousness. It's fine, perfectly fine. We can chant, dance, do kirtan, even watch Krishna conscious movies, no issues with that. But we have got the point wrong. The point there is, they are personification of Vedas and they put themselves in a very helpless position saying, always we are glorifying about jnana, upasana or some karmakanda here. Please give us a pure devotional service. Oh, dear gopis, we fall at your feet. Please give us mercy like that. Then they come and they keep on praying. Over a period of time, then they actually get liberated and they go. That's why among gopis, there is a category called Shrutichari gopis. That is, in the previous life, they were all Vedas. Actually. So every single time Krishna comes, Vedas get liberated, Vedas go. So sometimes I was thinking, you know, if sometimes someone asks us about, you know, Prabhu, tell us about Rasalila. We say like, it's very elevated topic, Prabhu, let's not speak. I was thinking, that's how Vedas will be speaking about themselves. Prabhu, do you know what Krishna is? I don't know, Prabhu. Better we just keep quiet. It's beyond our scope. Like that. Very advanced topic, later, like that. So that's how even personification of Vedas, this is how Bhaktivinoda Thakur is explaining. He's saying Vedas simply don't have the power. It's beyond their capacity to do. And here we are sitting and chanting Hare Krishna. Simply due to mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada. Keech. So that is why it's important for us to understand. With that appreciation, if we actually approach this, then our heart will be filled with gratitude. With that level. That's why it's very, very important how we approach, the mood with which we approach any class for that matter. Same, you put your headphone, I don't like this Prabhuji, I like only pastime lectures. No problem, here. But then don't expect a story in every second line. Prabhupada once, he was walking and Prabhupada was laughing and Tamal Krishna Maharaj was asking, Prabhupada, like that. And then Prabhupada is saying, they are thinking Krishna book is a storybook and Prabhupada is laughing. But I put all philosophy in it and Prabhupada is laughing again. And sometimes that's what, if you see Krishna book also, storyline will finish in two lines and then there'll be philosophy prayers. First time I told you read the book, I didn't tell you the second half. Whole flight went in searching story only. There's prayer. Initially you see nice picture. You expect some detail of that. Krishna is there in a ocean of milk and everything. And then immediately it went, Indra prays this, you know, Brahma prays this. That's okay. And then Krishna was born. Finished story. And then you realize, actually, this is correct. But what we need to be approaching there is, how is it this is going to be relevant? Now, I completely agree. It takes proper guidance. It takes certain expertise for somebody to teach us to make it interesting, to make it relevant. That is true. Mahatma Prabhu says, yes, scriptures are very transcendental, but that doesn't mean you come and come unprepared, give a boring class and expect people to feel inspired. And if people actually tell anything about you, you say, they are demons, Prabhu. That's not. So we should still be approaching scriptures in a proper mode. Pastimes are there. They will come all the time. But we should not be seeking pastime. We should understand we are part of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastime. We are part of Sri Radha Gopinath's pastime. We are thinking it's only 50 years now, right? In another 500 years, we will be some future generation. They'll be thinking we are all pure devotees of Krishna. Sometimes I laugh, you know, we are not. But that's how they'll think. But we may well be. We may well become one. Possible. If we simply take shelter of the scriptures. So there are four types of people here under Kanishta Adhikari: distressed, needy, inquisitive, and wise. And Prabhupada gives example. We discussed this in Bhagavad Gita also. For distressed, we know Gajendra. needy. Dhruva Maharaj, one who goes for a greater kingdom, in even greater than Lord Brahma. Inquisitive, sages of Naimisharanya. And those who are wise, those who are searching after absolute truth, we saw the four Kumaras. If you refer to your chapter 7, Bhagavad Gita notes, you will see. We discussed about this. So these are the different types of people who come. Krishna, as I said, even though they all come for some material. Now all four of them, they come for material reasons only. However, because they come to Krishna, because not every person who goes through depression goes to Krishna, every person who is stressed out goes to Krishna, Krishna is telling they are still pious. So it takes a certain amount of piety to come to Krishna. And that piety will also strengthen one's faith in Krishna. We saw even in Bhagavad Gita, of the four types of people, Krishna says the one who is wise is very, very special, more advanced than the other three. And the reason is, those who are distressed and needy, they come mainly for material reason, totally material reason. Some material trouble, they want relief from that material trouble. So they come for material reason. Same one who is needy, he or she wants something, they go and approach Krishna for the same material reason. So, inquisitiveness. Yes, they are inquisitive about solutions for problems in life, birth, death, old age and disease. Still, they have not completely taken shelter. There is still that, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu explains, they are serious about self-realization, but not so serious. Little casual. That's how Chaitanya Charan Prabhu explains. So that's inquisitiveness. Prabhupada categorizes them. If you read the purport in Nectar of Devotion, this chapter, you'll see Prabhupada still categorizes them to be coming under material, even though they are coming in the borderline. However, Prabhupada says those who are wise, they are there simply for spiritual reason. However, Prabhupada uses the word spiritual not in the pure sense of being devotional. In fact, the final section, Prabhupada actually explains there are three types of happiness. Material, second, Prabhupada says spiritual, and the third is devotional. In this particular context, but usually every other place in any book you actually take, Prabhupada always says material spiritual in a broad sense, meaning spiritual means devotional. But in this particular purport, Prabhupada, to explain between impersonalists, between Brahmavadis and pure devotees, Prabhupada introduces this category, devotional, separately. So material means those who are distressed and needy. Spiritual means those who are wise, but they are still not fully convinced about the personality of Godhead. They don't have much information about the Lord's name, fame, form, qualities, pastimes, everything. And because of that, they are still thinking, after I die, I can go and merge with the body of Krishna. Prabhupada is saying, so they are Brahmavadis. Prabhupada, in one conversation, he is saying, Socrates was a Brahmana. And Prabhupada is telling a pastime when Socrates was actually caught by the king's men because of their fear that he's actually changing the people's mind, taking them away from being loyal to the kingship. So they tell him, we are going to kill you. Prabhupada even says, they use the poison, hemlock. Prabhupada says that in one pastime, and he says, all right, we are going to kill you. How would you like to die? This was the question that's put forth to Socrates, and Prabhupada is saying, Socrates laughed at them and he told them, first you catch me, then we can discuss how you want to kill me. Which means Prabhupada is saying, Socrates, no, he's not the body. In one place, Prabhupada is saying, so Prabhupada says, that's Brahmana, he's already a Brahmana. Okay, he knows he's beyond this body. So those who are in wise category, same, they also have that knowledge. They are not the body, they are the soul. Four Kumaras, they knew. That's why they were not even covering their body, because they knew they are not the body. So they were not covering the body, they know they are spiritual. However, they had the impersonal conception about Krishna. They didn't know that Krishna has a form. They didn't know Krishna has a name. Krishna has qualities. Krishna has senses. They didn't know that. Because of that, Prabhupada says that is spiritual.
Prabhu, could it be Mayavadi as well?
Let's finish. And third one is devotional. Devotional means, Prabhupada says, one who is fully engaged in a complete knowledge of Krishna, engaged in full service of Krishna. Such people come into the category of devotional. Such people's happiness. So Prabhupada says people seek happiness in different levels. These ones, they sought happiness in material level. They are still good because they came to Krishna. But something higher than that is those who are in wise category, who don't have any material problem. Nevertheless, they still come to Krishna, seeking some higher truth. However, the one who is in the topmost category is devotees. Those who seek devotional pleasure, devotional happiness. Sevananda. So that by the joy that comes out of devotional service. So Prabhupada says that is the topmost platform to aspire for. And towards the end of this chapter, the concluding verses, you will see one characteristics of pure devotional service we saw. Pure devotional service, moksha lagutakrit, he derides, even despises, hates, liberation even. So Prabhupada, he touches on that aspect. The last few verses you will see, Kapiladev's quote, Prabhupada says, my pure devotees, they come, they serve. Even if I actually offer them four types of liberation, they say they reject it. What are the four types of liberation? Sarupya, Salokya, Sarishti, Samipya. They are the four types of liberation. I'll just finish with this point. So there are four types of liberation. Sarupya, Salokya, Samipya, Sarishti. Which means if devotees, they practice devotional service, after they quit this body, they then assume four-handed form and they get one of these four different types of liberations, usually. Except the Gaudiyas. Those followers of Krishna, it's a different category. This is theory for us. This is not what we are aspiring for. But this is how generally followers of Vishnu, they attain one of the four. If you see Kamsa, or if you see Shishupal is a different category. Whenever you worship Krishna, whoever saw in four-handed form, whenever we come across the pastimes where say they assumed a four-handed form and they left like the fishes, they go in one of them. Sarupya means after we give up this body, by the way, all four are in Vaikuntha only. It's not impersonal, it's still personal, it's just more detail about how everyone will be engaged in Vishnu service. Sarupya means to have the form rupa. Okay, sarupya. To have the form exactly same as the Supreme Lord. In some pictures, if you read Bhagavatam, you will see there'll be one Vishnu, but there'll be many with 400 form also. Have you seen? That is sarupya mukti. Okay, you be there in the spiritual world, but with the 400 form. So that is sarupya. Salokya. Salokya means you are in the same loka. So that's the keyword. Rupa is rupya. Loka means you are in the same world. You are in the same planet as the Supreme Lord. So that's the second type of liberation. Samipya. Samipya means you are very close. Very one of the inner circle of the Supreme Lord. Okay. Close personal confidence. Or could be a maid servant in the same palace where the Lord is residing. Like that. Sarishti. You have exactly same opulence as the Supreme Lord. So that is Sarishti. Now Krishna is saying, my devotees, they are so much engaged, they derive so much pleasure by doing devotional service to me and my devotees, so much so, even if I offer any of this, they just reject it. Okay? One fifth type of liberation, which is not, this is devotional, the fifth type of liberation which doesn't come under this, it's not really liberation, temporary liberation, is Sayujya Mukti. Sayujya is merging in the Brahman. So that's the Sayujya. But as I said, that's not devotional. But this is four types of devotional liberation only. It's still our existence in Vaikuntha, but it is in one of them. But for us, we don't technically go in each one of those categories. You can still see, you know, Salokya, you can say we are still going to be in Goloka Vrindavan. But usually we don't. For devotees of Krishna, we usually don't put any of that as the category. Usually this is for Vaikuntha. Even though you can still justify some of them to be true, even for Goloka Vrindavan. So Prabhupada says, so somebody who follows on this path of bhakti, if they are seeking spiritual pleasure, it's still temporary, but one who is in devotional happiness, simply by doing devotional service to the Krishna, even if Krishna is saying, even if I come and offer any one of this, they are saying, no, I don't want, I just want only devotional service. They are very clear with that, like that. So we'll finish with that. I'll first finish Ujjala Mataji's question. Yes, they can also be Mayavadis. But Mayavadis, technically, Prabhupada don't even dignify them as one of the spiritualists. Brahmavadis are innocent. We were discussing that. In this context, Prabhupada uses only Brahmavadis. Bona fide impersonalists are Brahmavadis. Mayavadis, Prabhupada don't put in that category. So we don't bring them into picture at all. Rasika Mataji. No. They can, maybe, but somebody may be in the same world, but not the same form as the Lord.
That's the only one, but the others like
even others possible also. Somebody may not be always closer to the Lord with a different form. See, somebody can live in the same world, but not closer. So they can be mutually exclusive as well, or somebody may be having one or more of them also possible. But it's just given four types of liberation.
With you know, we earlier you were talking about, you know, initially often we have that attraction, that bhakti, and then it's quite overwhelming sometimes, and then things change.
Fizzled out.
So why is that? Like, why is it?
Indriduna Maharaj says Vaishnava Parad. Because we go too close, we start to offend, so we start to lose what we have. It's not really losing. Kadamkana Maharaj explains, bhakti still has its effect. It's like you earn the money, you put it in the bank, but the bank account is frozen. You can't debit it anymore because of Vaishnava Parad. So,
I guess my question is though, that initial attraction and that initial awakening, it's kind of, where did that come?
Okay, good question. So the question is the question here is, not so much why it actually dwindled. The question here is, how did we get that initial attraction? I gave this analogy before, sample soap. You go to a shopping mall, somebody will give you sample soap. It comes for free, just for you to try out. Krishna gives that sample ecstasy, part of the process, for us to get some glimpse. So that's exactly what happened even in Narada Muni's case. Krishna came, showed, and then immediately he pulled out, just to evoke enough interest, so now you'll crave. Krishna says exactly same thing even to the gopis. In the discussion between Krishna and gopis, you will see. Krishna says, just like a pauper, a poor man, if he gets a gold coin and he loses it, how much he'll crave. Krishna is saying, that is why I stay away from devotees. I give them the prema, but to evoke that level of greed, that level of craving, I also detach myself like that. For us, we can understand, we can all be honest with ourselves and we see, because Vaishnava Parad we can do with Deha Vak Buddhi, by speech, by body, like fighting literally, or even by mentally. So we can gauge all of this. That was one thing there's one book called Madhurya Kadambini. It discusses in detail about Anartha Nivritti, especially. Some other time we can discuss. But if you read that, it gives us clearly checkpoints. Based on what you can understand where you are, based on what you can actually understand how you are progressing in this process. Based on what anartha or based on what symptoms you can actually understand which stage I am in, it clearly tells. Prabhupada also clearly tells as we progress in bhakti, Prabhupada gave us everything in a way we can understand easily. Prabhupada's point is, you see how much you are getting attracted to materialistic pleasure. That's one litmus test. If you are losing taste for materialistic pleasure, Prabhupada is saying, that's a good sign of progress. Another thing Prabhupada says, you see how much you are getting taste for hearing. That's another one. How much you are feeling dependent. Rupa Goswami says, how much we are feeling dependent on other Vaishnavas. That's another one. Like that, we can go keep each one of them as KPIs and see how we are doing. I'll take just one more question. Okay.
How do you unfreeze a bank account?
Okay, good question. How do we unfreeze if we actually do Vaishnava Parad, devotional service? We just serve. If we know specifically a particular devotee who we offended, we have to go and ask for apology. We have to go and ask for forgiveness. Please forgive me. Please bless me. I did something wrong. Please relieve me of this. We have to. If we don't know, that is why even early morning, every time we come to temple, we pay obeisances. We don't know who we are actually offended. So we pay obeisances just to make sure that even knowingly, unknowingly, any aparad we have, might have actually done, we do. But if it is, we know specifically one particular devotee, there is no other way but to actually approach the person and get ourselves relieved. Yes, yes.
So my question is a little bit complicated and funny because I'm still trying to figure out what my question is. My question is regarding what you said.
How am I supposed to answer then?
So you said whoever is given the class, we should cherish the class. That's what you said.
We should try to approach simply to get the message from them. Yeah.
Then point is that association is very important and we should be very cautious about our association. And then I heard in a lecture by Sri Prad Aindra Prabhu, he said that before anything else, person needs to have something to give something. So he was chanting 64 rounds before giving kirtan. So some kirtans are really powerful and you want to sit in the temple, you want to be ecstatic, you want to be dancing. Sometimes you don't want to be in the kirtan, you don't want to hear. And he said that's all right because probably this person who is singing doesn't have anything to give, so it's empty. And you said that we should be cherishing everything. So how do we understand that sometimes we don't get any, like, no rasa in Srimad Bhagavatam class? Is it my anartha and my sins, yes, and my false ego,
yes,
and my aparad that I'm not able to relish it? Or is it what Sripad Aindra Prabhu is saying, that that person doesn't have anything?
Good question. One prayer which Niranjan Maharaj says, as speakers, every speaker of Bhagavatam or any class they should offer to Krishna is, oh my dear Lord, all these devotees have come to hear your message through me. Please make me your instrument. If somebody goes with that prayerful mode, Krishna will communicate to the audience through them. Because just like I'm saying, there is anarthas from the listener's side, there are potential anarthas even from speaker's side also. They want to keep it, like, you know, very enlivening. Suddenly the attraction, rather than Krishna, it can potentially be directing towards them, the speaker themselves. To answer your question, what is our qualification to be able to give? Only if I have, I can give something. Our only qualification is we have the order of our spiritual master. Prabhupada said, preach, we preach. That's our only qualification. Whether we have something or not, that's not our problem. That's Krishna's problem. So anyone and everyone in ISKCON, we are qualified to preach. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said this instruction, which is applicable for each and every member of our sampradaya, especially for ISKCON, is Yare Dekho Tare Kaho Krishna Upadesh. This instruction Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives. Prabhupada is saying in one place. And same instruction I'm taking and I'm giving. We have order of Prabhupada from now for eternity, any ISKCON member can preach. Let me finish there. So that was one thing. And in terms of listening, if someone actually goes, we don't get taste, it's okay. It's okay to feel bored. But that should not be an excuse for us to walk out of the class. That should not be an excuse to deter us from coming and attending the class. It shouldn't be. That's when Vaidhi Bhakti kicks in. As a matter of duty, sit in the class. As a matter of duty, give that little nudge to yourself. We'll feel happy. Over a period of time, we'll feel the taste. Same, that's exactly what happened even with Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, beauty is we can put our melody, dance, even if you don't like anything, you can just bang something. Somewhere you can engage. Class means you have to just sit. Japa means there is you holding them, nothing else. Beat also doesn't move fast. It gets hard, actually. We need to finish it here. Thank you so much for your kind attention. We'll discuss later. Oh, yes, thank you. Now, somebody asked me if there is a study guide for this one, like Surrender Unto Me. This is a beautiful book by Danudar Swami, Waves of Devotion. We don't have copies here. We may not get it, but if anyone likes to buy online, you can. It's called Waves of Devotion. It's a really, really beautiful book. Just like how Surrender Unto Me was written closely coupled with Prabhupada's purports, this book is also like that. He will even tell you the page number. This is what Prabhupada says it like that. It definitely helps you to understand the flow, if anyone interested. We can come here, have a look, take a picture. Now, this is the summary for Srimad Bhagavatam. We have it till 6 cantos here. We have it means I have the sample copy only. We are going to place orders. If anyone is interested, you can go through. We don't know the price, but roughly when I was calculating, each one will come to about $10. But this is third canto in all. And of the guides, this is first and second canto altogether, actually. So there are not those many. This is fifth and sixth altogether. Really, devotees have put, this is by the Vada form, Govardhan Eco Village, Bhakti Vedanta Vidyapit. Devotees have put really lot of hard work. This is one entire chapter. Just if you look at it, you'll understand it. How easily they have made, like high school textbooks basically. It'll tell you the flow. It'll tell you, it'll highlight the verses. There are, it gives you a good bird's eye view about Bhagavatam. And that is one big challenge we always have with Bhagavatam. It just scares, the sheer volume of that scares us. So there are some here, you can come here, have a look. If you are interested, you can place. I'm still waiting. The Surrender Unto Me books have arrived. It's still with the Bhakti Shastri team. I'm waiting for them to take. And then once it comes, and then I'll pass. Whoever gave names, you can take a copy. And whoever wants, if there are additional copies, you can take. Sorry, I'm over time. We'll finish here. You can have a look here, but it is my copy. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki, Shri Shri Radha Gopinath Bhagwan ki, Samaveda Gaur Bhakta Vrind ki, Jai Nittai Gaur Premanande. One quick announcement.